privilege to be here today speaking with you. Pastor John Caldwell sent an email about 3 weeks ago, and he said, you're a teacher, you're an elder, you're a veteran. Please preach. So I took that as somewhat of a compliment, but I'd like to know how many people here served in the military or married at the time, had spouses or families. I just want to take this time to say thank you. That's something that's near and dear to my heart because I spent 20 years and we had a family. And it's a tremendous burden for them. You can't imagine the things they go through. I was away from home in one of my jobs quite often. A lot of times they didn't even know where I was, what I was doing. But I thank God that they stood beside me the whole time. And I thank all the spouses and the families here also that are married to veterans. Thank you for your service as well. When I retired from the military, I got a letter of appreciation. I got a big thing from the president. Flag was flown over the national capital. But along with that, my family also got one. So it was a personal thank you from the President of the United States to my family for putting up with all the stuff that goes on when you're doing that job. Also want to thank my dad for being here. He hasn't been here for 2 years. Unfortunately, my mom's not here. That's the one other person I wish was here. But she's really here, and she's hearing a better message today than we are. Being in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, ministering to her. And I thank God that He is her Savior. I struggled with this for the past couple of weeks. What am I going to say? What am I going to talk about? Prayed about it, nothing came. Had a lot of ideas, they weren't progressing. And then about 3 or 4 days ago, the Lord said, I think I want to preach. I think I want you to talk about Psalm 33. Now, this is not an Independence Day message, so any of you that got your hopes up, I'm sorry. But that's not what the Lord is leading me to do today. Has a little bit initially to do with that kind of stuff, but overall, when we look at everything, it's not going to end up being that. I want you to imagine that you turned on the TV and looking at the news, and you heard these three announcements. The Chief Justice of the Supreme Court has just issued this statement. Divine providence has given to our people the choice of their rulers, and it is the duty as well as the privilege and interest of our Christian nation to select and prefer Christians for their rulers. The next one is inquiries by our reporters reveal that almost every state legislator has now passed a law requiring all elected officials to take this oath. I do profess faith in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ, His only Son, and I do acknowledge the Holy Scriptures and the Old and New Testaments to be given in divine inspiration. Third one I'd like us to consider is legislation was passed today in Congress to affirm that the Congress of the United States approves of and recommends the Holy Bible for future or for use in the schools. What do you think the response of the people would be? Not to mention the secular media. Most of them probably wouldn't even pay attention to it, I wouldn't think. But it would catch some attention, I believe. Amazingly, all these three things are factual. These are three facts that were actually said. The first one was John Jay, the very first Chief Justice, often called the father of the Supreme Court. He was one of the primary writers of our Constitution. He wrote, it is the duty of our Christian nation to select and prefer Christians for their rulers. The second one is, it was the state of Delaware, along with many others that followed suit, which required office holders to take that oath, affirming their Christian faith before they could take office. Pretty amazing. And the last one, not only did Congress in 1782 approve the use in Bibles, of the Bibles in schools, they also purchased them. They purchased 22,000 of them with more tax dollars for other tax dollars. In 1844, somebody challenged that and sued to remove them, and the Supreme Court ruled, why should not the Bible, and especially the New Testament, be read and taught as a divine revelation in schools? Where can the purest principles of morality be learned so clearly or so perfectly as from the New Testament? Wow. That's encouraging. Unfortunately, we see how far the courts really have moved from that, and the rest of the country as a whole. When we think of the 4th of July, what do we think about? If you're a kid, probably school is out. Gonna go swimming, gonna have some fun, ride my bike, spend all the time I want with my friends, maybe go on vacation. I think about picnics, fireworks, Saturday at Harry and Darla's house. Most of all, though, I think the main thing that we think about is freedom. And again, this is not a 4th of July message for you, but we think about freedom. Freedom's perhaps the most central thing, the central part of the founding of our nation. It was our nation's fathers who were, the majority of them, and I believe it's only three of them, were not professing Christians. And the other three actually used the Bible for their moral consultation. They took that, they looked to that for divine guidance. To be an American is to be free. That's one of that's the main focal point of our country here. We are a free country to do whatever we want to do within the guidelines of the law. It means to be a free person. When our country first, when people first came over, they were not free. They were beholden to the British government. And that's why we fought a war. Then after that, in fact, there were some signers of the Declaration of Independence who owned slaves. And that wasn't a particularly good time in the history of our country. But now everybody in our country can come here and say, I am a free person in this country to do as I please in accordance with the law. Freedom, we're surrounded by it. We hear about it all the time. There's songs about it. It's one of those things that we really take for granted a lot, but we must appreciate that. And again, this is not an Independence Day message for you. But I'd like to take your Bibles and turn to Psalm chapter 33. We're going to start at verse 12. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven, the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place, he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do, no king is saved by the size of his army. No war escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. I'm not a person who does well without some notes, so if you bear with me, I like a few of them to kind of remind me where I'm at now and then. Blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord. Very familiar too, as we hear that all over the place. We see it on TV, we even say that. We are a blessed nation. Yes, we are. We are a blessed nation. It's true that our nation was founded upon the scriptures. We see that even the Declaration of Independence points to that. It's full of references, not directly, but it's full of references to both God and the scriptures. So everything is based upon that. I was hoping that some things in our Constitution were, but they are not. I read that this past week, and I thought maybe there had been, but there is not anything in there that goes back to that at all. But it's based on that Declaration of Independence, which refers to God and the Holy Scriptures. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. The idea here, well, when this was written, at the time this was written to the Israelites. They were a blessed nation. And the idea here that we have is that we have a happy nation, we have a joyous nation. It's a condition that the nation is in. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Whose God is the Lord. And here we're referring to Yahweh, the Hebrew word Yahweh. A nation that worships Yahweh, a nation that worships God is under His protection. And that's kind of the way it's been in our history. We are self-described as a Christian nation. And so we feel that we have been blessed. I think this was written to distinguish such a nation as the Israelites from those who were pagan nations, who had false gods, worshipped idols, those sort of things. And such a nation is happy, is blessed, because Yahweh is a true God. He's a true God. He's real, not an imagination. A nation is blessed because His laws are just and good. Everything that He sets in place is meant to promote public welfare, to promote prosperity, not necessarily monetarily or materially, spiritually. A nation is blessed because Yahweh's protection will be graciously given to such a nation as that. A nation is blessed because His worship and the influence of His word, they disperse virtue, intelligence, purity, truth, those kinds of things. And those are dispersed over a land and will ultimately promote welfare, good welfare, not like we have this day, good welfare. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and continuing, and the people He chose for His inheritance. That's a very important statement there. And the people whom He chose for His own inheritance. So we find here, not only is the nation blessed, but we find that what is good for the nation is good for the person as well. We find that with our nation. Our nation is blessed. We have vast natural resources, we have wealth, we have intelligence. We are probably the most progressive nation on the earth as far as technology and those kinds of things. And so we are a blessed nation. People. It's the same for the people as it is for a nation. They are chosen. We are chosen as a part of our nation. What is true about the nation is true about the people. This statement was true back then to the Israelites. They were chosen to be Him. And this reference is undoubtedly to these people, and they are called God's inheritance. I'd like you to turn over to 1 Peter chapter 2 with me. We'll start at verse 1, 3 through verse 10. Starts out, therefore, because what Christ did for you in the previous chapter, he talks about that, what he did for each of you, what you are gaining from that, because you are loving each other through your salvation. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices accepted to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, see, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to you who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become a capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not his people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So Peter, in his letter here, now is connecting us with the Old Testament. He's saying, because you are now are chosen by God, you are God's child, you are blessed. Now you're going to get the blessings that I have given to the Israelites. You're going to have all of this stuff. You will inherit these things. Israel was chosen, had a priesthood, it was the holy nation, it had people belonging to God. But now that Christ has come, we're that holy nation, God's people, not physical landmark. God's holy nation does not exist between the Pacific and the Atlantic Ocean. Peter knew nothing about America. He did not know that it was going to exist. And so I believe these words were meant for us, God's church, his holy people. We are a holy people. And so what here is affirmed to our Psalm 33 applies to us through 1 Peter chapter 2. We are a chosen people. We're a holy nation. God showered these blessings upon Israel, and he showers these blessings upon us. Not as our physical nation, the United States of America, but on his chosen people, us, those who have gained salvation through Jesus Christ. We're a holy nation as the church. The church is a blessed nation. We receive all of God's blessings. We receive everything that he gave Israel. When the United States, well, when people came from Spain to America, they came to discover the New World, across thousands of miles of ocean. We, as God's chosen people, are also waiting for the New World, the true New World. And God has promised that to us. And when does that come? When Jesus comes physically back to this earth for his people. And we will be with him forever. You see, the nation of God doesn't just encompass America. It encompasses his whole people, his holy church. No matter where you are around this globe, doesn't matter what country you're born in, doesn't doesn't matter where you're standing at the time, doesn't matter where your passport is from, no matter where you got your driver's license, anything like that, you are a part of the nation of God. I'm going to take a look at a couple slides here. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. We see an American flag next to this church. And somehow we believe as Americans that we are the only ones that are blessed. When he's talking about, when Peter's talking about us, God's chosen people, somehow in our arrogance we think that this belongs solely to us. That's not what it says in the scripture. If we really understand what it means to be the church, then we're going to take Peter's words to heart about being that holy nation. The next one we'll look at, we have the flag of Israel here. Israel was the holy nation. They were the nation of God. They were the blessed people. But are they that today? I don't think these words would refer to the nation of Israel either. Not holy. Seeing where they are these days, all they've been through, they're scattered everywhere throughout the world. This can't be pointed to them. They're not a holy nation. Why? They don't believe that Jesus Christ came. They don't believe that the Messiah came to this earth. They cannot be part of the holy nation at this point in time. Will they? Certainly they will be, but not at this time. So that's not what this is talking about. What's this talking about? Well, the next one is going to show us, again, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. This church, this is the nation of God. We are his people. We don't have to have a flag that says we are the nation of God. Like I said, it doesn't matter where in the world you are, what country you were born, anything like that. That does not place you in a particular spot that is marked the nation of God. We're a holy nation. We're citizens of the kingdom of God. In the book of Hebrews in chapter 11, the author there holds up Abraham as an example of having faith in God. Abraham trusted God. God promised him that his offspring would be a great nation. But even when Abraham was shown the promised land, which was a geographical place, they were shown that as their home. Abraham was looking forward to a city, a different city, a different nation, whose architect and builder is the Lord. And we've been given that privilege when Christ came to this earth and left and established the church. We have been brought together to be a people belonging to God. Somehow we have to rid ourselves of the idea that we, again, as Americans, are not the holy nation of God. Think about it. What is America now? I mean, there's so much stuff going on here. I've got a couple statements I'd like to share with you. From President Obama, he proudly stated in 2008 that the United States is no longer a Christian nation. Then in 2009, he embraced the idea that the United States would become a secular nation. He was in Turkey at the time and referring to their secular nation. And he stated that we do not consider ourselves a Christian nation. Maybe he should have checked with the 78% of people that claim they have an affiliation with Christianity and not make that statement as representing the entire country. I don't agree with him. I don't think our forefathers would agree with him. Our country has come so far away from what the founders of our country ever dreamed that it would be. They've misinterpreted law. They've misinterpreted the Constitution. They misinterpreted the Declaration of Independence. They did all these things because they're not followers of God. They have rejected Him. They have rejected His Word. So therefore, the nation is not, they say, is not founded upon biblical principles. This president, and I'm not bashing him, this president has steered this nation so far away from its founding principles than any other president or political official in history. Again, I'm not picking on him. He claimed to be a Christian. He claimed to have a personal experience with Jesus Christ. I'm not gonna challenge that. I'm gonna leave that up to my God and do that. But everything that he has done, everything that he says is contrary to what we believe as Christians. I have a list this long of things that he has done against Christianity, or said against Christianity. The holy nation is the church. The holy nation is blessed. We have received all of these promises that God made to Israel in the Old Testament. I found, and I'm not going to read it, but I found another way of saying Psalm 33. And we look at it from our perspective, from the Christian perspective. And we place ourselves in that. And when we do that, it really hits home. It makes you see what this stuff is really talking about. It's not just addressed to the nation of Israel. It's addressed to all of God's people. We can pray Psalm 33. And I'm not saying that we should be praying for our nation. But when we do pray for our nation, we should be asking for wisdom. We should be asking for all these things that we as Christians see as necessary, things that God has promised us, these things being enacted and put in place. Pray for God's unfailing love upon His church and His people around the world. We must be confident of God's love for us. I found this, and I think this is, well, this is in our text. We're confident of God's love. We're confident that we have His protection on us. He says here, "You are a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of Him who called you out of the darkness into His wonderful light." That's an awesome statement. That's an awesome statement. When He calls us and we come out of that darkness and we come into the light and we accept Him into our lives and we follow Him and we do all these things, that's a beautiful statement. We are strengthened in faith. We are forgiven of our sins. We're prepared for service in His name. We talked a little bit about that today in Sunday school. We talked about the Church of Ephesus and how God, or Jesus, was pleased with the things that they were doing, and they were serving diligently, and they were dedicated. They were driven. But then he found that one thing against them. "But this I hold against you." And I think God ultimately is looking at our nation, the nation, his chosen people. And he's seeing all these good things that we're doing. And that church, and I don't know who all here studied Revelation, but each one of those churches represents us, not only as churches in these times, but as individuals. So as we leave here, I want us to maybe take a look at Revelation chapter 2. Look at the church of Ephesus. See how they were. And it tells us that they were driven, that they were dedicated. And those words don't just mean something that, okay, they kept doing this and this. They did it to the best of their ability. They worked. They labored. They labored to the point of almost exhaustion. That's what it's telling us. Are we doing that? Are we laboring like we should? I don't think so. So we all need to search our own hearts. And I want us to remember this. We see things, and I talked about this in class too, we see things from the outside. We see how we are, we see how other people are. But there's a person who sees us differently from the inside. He sees our heart. There's nothing hidden from him. He has those blazing eyes of fire that burn through everything, reveals everything that's hidden. We can't hide anything from him. Nothing. We can pretend. We can't hide anything. He knows our hearts. So knowing that, we need to make sure that we are right with him and that we're not trying to hide anything. Because if we are, we're going to be like what's happening to our nation now. I fear that God is departing our nation. We have gone so far from his principles. Remember David when he prayed. He prayed as if for his nation, as if it was him. That's how we need to pray. We have sinned. We have done all these things, and we need to ask for forgiveness. We need to pray for our country. Because, like I said, I fear God is going to turn his back on this country. We already see things going on. We see the financial instability that is going on. We see all the corruption in government. It's said that you can't be an elected official without being corrupt. I hear that a lot. I believe a lot of that. We need to pray for our country. We're a chosen people. We're a royal priesthood. And we are a holy nation. I'd like all of us to say that with some gusto. Okay? So repeat after me. We are a chosen people.
We are a chosen people.
We are a royal priesthood.
We are a royal priesthood.
We are a holy nation.
We are a holy nation.
Do you believe that? Do you really believe that? I hope so. I really hope so. It's through Jesus Christ that we are chosen to be his servants, to be his holy church, to take the message of salvation to everybody. Everybody. Would you pray with me? Father God, I thank you for this nation that you've given us. You have blessed us tremendously. You have given us so many things beyond measure. I pray for our officials, Father, our elected officials, that they might turn to you, God, for every single decision that they are considering. We know there's so much corruption that's going on, Lord, and these days it seems like it is not we the people for the people, but it is we the politicians for ourselves. We the politicians for the people who put money in their pockets. For those people, Father, I pray, Lord, that they may see the light, that you may reveal yourself to them. Help them, Father, them to realize what they are doing. Help them to realize that they are sinning against you, Holy God. And draw them to repentance and ultimately forgiveness. Father, I pray for this church, that we may be part of your holy nation. I pray that we open ourselves up to you today for use, for your service, whatever your pleasure may be. In Jesus' name.